it's Lauren and Rizzo with Lauren Elizabeth Fine Art, and I help beginner through professional level artists reduce stress while mastering animal art. So to celebrate 10,000 subscribers and just being on this channel for over 2 years now, and then with Valentine's coming up, I wanted to give you this tutorial, which is jam-packed with so much of what I've learned, especially recently on painting dogs. So as I walk you through how to paint this Doberman Pinscher, step by step using acrylics, and this is even for beginners, I will talk about some really juicy, helpful tips that have helped me so much in painting short-haired dogs, medium-haired dogs, long-haired dogs, tips for painting noses, eyes. So this is a really special video that I'm really happy to share. Now, if you don't want to watch the whole thing all the way through, I've actually linked down below just a summary of some of the tips that I go over. So you can check that out. I've also provided a traceable printout, which is also linked down below, so that you can just transfer this sketch drawing of the Doberman Pinscher onto your canvas or your paper and just jump right into this painting. Now, if you watch all the way to the end of the video, I share this really important announcement, this really exciting news that I will be doing coming very soon. And so you'll just have to wait and see. It's at the very end of this tutorial. All right, guys, without further ado, let's get painting. So the sketch outline that you transferred to your canvas is looking much cleaner and tidier than mine is right now. And we're going to work on the background first using aqua green, white, and deep yellow. I want to use more aqua green and white and just a little bit of yellow. I'm going to start by using a flat brush. This is a large flat brush, working from left to right as I move around the Doberman Pinscher sketch. And I want to get as close to that sketch outline as possible. It's better to go over my sketch than have little white spots left over. Now, my artist style is right there in between abstract and realistic. I don't like when things are perfectly blended and pristine and perfect, but I also like things to look pretty realistic and similar to the reference photo. So as I'm blending on my canvas, I'm just allowing the paint to kind of do its thing. I'm also trying to cover up the white, moving from left to right, keeping the left side more yellow with more of my deep yellow. And then as I move to the middle and to the right, I'm going to add in more aqua green and white. And then we have the most amount of white in our paint mixture once we get to the far right side. And take this time to take 5 long, deep breaths to get really comfy and focused on just your painting, the canvas, and my voice, to shut off any racing thoughts on your mind, and to really become centered on your painting. My first dog painting tip is start with your background. Now, if you're not sure of what color to use for your background, that's okay. You can indeed start with the dog first, laying down your darkest tones first, and then your medium tones, and then your light tones. However, I don't suggest adding any fur texture, making it look like there's any fur until that background has been laid down and is completed. It's very important because what happens is then you have to apply another layer, getting in around all those tiny little fur strands with your background. So that's just something that can be a real nuisance. I've been there before when I decided to change the background color, but it's just really annoying to have to do that. It's best to kind of plan it out so that you have your background done first and then go in with the layers on your dog. Now, you really don't have to worry too much when you have a very, very short haired dog like this Doberman Pinscher, but it's especially important to lay down your background first when you have a long haired dog. Now, when it comes to choosing what colors for your dog, I recommend if you have a dark colored animal to use a light colored or medium toned background. If you have a light colored animal, then I suggest a dark or medium to dark colored background. All right, so I have my background laid down. If you didn't already, make sure you do the sides as well, especially if you already have this color wet on your paint palette. And next, we're gonna move on to our nostrils and the eyes using a round detail brush. Now for the next tip, using black, you wanna start by filling in the nostrils and outlining any black, really dark areas around the nose, as well as the mouth and around the eyes. Doberman Pinschers have really dark noses. However, the light source, which I can pinpoint is coming from above and especially to the left, by looking at the nose, I am noticing that it's just gonna be a outline of black around the nose. I'm not really gonna be filling in the nose itself with black. That would lose the nostrils that we just filled in. So for this particular breed, I'll use a gray, or my favorite, I'll use blue values that match the values from the reference photo to fill in the nose. So if you're not sure what value is, it's the relative lightness or darkness of a color. It's something that I really pay close attention to in all my paintings. So you're able to use any color you want as long as it has the correct value according to the reference photo. And so you're welcome to use gray instead of the blue that I use, as long as it follows the correct values or shapes, because we can actually literally find the shapes of each different value in the nose, you're welcome to apply that color. Now, if you want to learn how to paint any cat or dog, maybe your own pets, or maybe you've been commissioned to do somebody else's pet, I have an online Inmart Masterclass full of over 100 pet and wildlife tutorials that really break it down for you step by step in real time how to do this. I've designed this class in a way that helps beginner through professional level artists reduce stress, manage anxiety, depression, even addiction, all while building your skills in acrylic animal art. What students really love is the monthly Masterclass Artist Challenge that I host that focuses on self-reflection and building your skills and animal art. So if you or a friend would be interested in this, all the links are down below. Now let's get back to painting this Doberman Pinscher. Next, I'm going to move on to those really dark areas around the lips and mouth. This dog has its mouth closed, so there's really not much light getting in there. So I'm just going to kind of outline around the bottom part of the lips. Now I'm looking for the darkest darks, so I'm not going to be applying black where I see more brownish tones or light grays. I'm only applying black to the areas that are our darkest values. Now for my next tip, do you notice that as I'm working on these lips that I miss a very dark section kind of further back on the lower lip? Well, what I learned recently is that if you forget or you missed applying a certain value, that's okay. You can either apply that same color later when you pinpoint it, or you can mix up an entirely different color of that same value. Now let's pause for 1 minute and just focus on this eye. We'll go back to that thought in a second. I think this dog actually hurt his left eye. It looks like it's been sewn shut. And so to make that look more natural, I opened it up using my black. So I'm gonna outline both eyes, but on that far our right eye, I'm gonna open it up so we just see the corner of it. Now what I recommend for this step, using our black, is to outline the eyes and fill in the pupils for the pupils that we see. Now, I think the reason I didn't fill in the pupil here is because I also like to outline the highlight, but if I'm pretty confident that I can find that highlight again, I'll just fill in the eyes completely with black. And I think because I wasn't sure where that highlight would be placed, I just simply outlined the eye and the inner part of it. So you can fill it in now. I'm gonna fill it in later. It's up to you. I'm switching to a round brush that's just a little bit bigger than the round detail brush that we were just using. You can also use a very small flat brush. Specifically, the one I'm using is size 4 Master's Touch. We're gonna start adding color to the nose. And like I said before, I like to distort color, but still playing on the same values we see in the reference photo. And so we're gonna do that using our blue. I'm using phthalo blue, white, and a little bit of black here because I wanna work on my darker tones first in the nose. So that's phthalo blue, white, and black. Where I see this dark value is on the top of the nose, around the indent between the nostrils, and around the nostrils and the lower part of the nose. So that's where I see these darker areas. Now, that leads me to my next tip. It's better to be very generous with your paint in the first beginning layers when we're applying our dark tones and medium tones. Right now we're just applying our dark tones because it's very easy to just simply layer over top afterwards. So we want to cover up our white. That's our biggest focus, is not to focus on detail right now. We're focused on covering up white, but still trying to block in where those values are. All right, so I blocked in all the darkest areas, I think. I can always paint them in later if I've missed any. And now I'm adding white to the same paint mixture, and I'm just gonna go a little bit lighter. These tones that are just a little bit lighter are gonna layer over top, as well as hug a lot of the colors that we just applied. We're building up layer after layer, and a lot of times they're just gonna be either laying right over top or what I call hugging the previous layers. Now, if your color isn't just right, that's okay. You can apply it to one area, test it out. I like to do lots of different testings of colors, and then once I find the right one, I'll just continue painting. So right there is a great example. I found it to be too dark, so I go in with more phthalo blue and more white. I mix it up and I try again. Now the reason why it's so important to be very generous with these beginning layers is because oftentimes it can leave white spots if you're trying to plug in every exact value in the right spot. So sometimes very experienced artists can do that and they can pull it off. But for beginners, I recommend starting with just being very generous with those initial layers, the dark tones and the medium tones, so that you can just simply layer over top those lighter highlights and medium tones, because that'll just get rid of a lot of the white specks that you might have left over. I'm gonna pull in some more white because I'm layering up to a very light blue, and that's trying to capture the lightest highlight, the lightest value on the left side of that nose and kind of in the middle. It kind of spans from the left side up and on top where it's just sitting above those nostrils. My next tip is that acrylic dries darker than the color that we see it while it's wet. So this is a darker color. We're working with kind of navy blues and blues, and then kind of some medium tone blues. And so once this dries, we're gonna notice, hey, why does that look so much darker? I thought I added so much white to that. Well, that's because acrylic just dries darker, and you'll likely have to go in with some different mixture of your white and phthalo blue to really pull out those highlights that you can just layer over top. So lots of layers, even in the nose, you're talking about like 5, 6, 7 layers, but that's oftentimes what it requires. I see some white spots that I left, and so I'm going back to paint that's thankfully still wet on my paint palette. The darker layers that we applied before, I'm just gonna go back to that and reapply them so I cover up any white spots. So if you're just not sure what color I'm using, that would be phthalo blue. a little bit of black and white just to kind of get that navy blue, those dark tones that we started with. If you see any areas that maybe you added blues into where it's black, like the nostrils or the lines that we made, just take some black and touch those areas up. I've added cadmium red to my paint palette because now we're going to start working on that eye, but I'll use black first. I'm just filling in that eye like I suggested you do earlier, but if not, fill that in now. Now let's get that little area just that we left white in the eye. I'm gonna wash out my brush and use cadmium red with some white and raw sienna. I wanna create this brownish red and very carefully just paint in where we have the white left over in the eye. And then while that's wet, I'm gonna go straight in with white paint. I want my brush to be clean and damp but not sopping wet. And I wanna blend that in, just lightening it up straight on my canvas. I like to do this a lot. Blending is only possible when our paint is wet. If it dries, which doesn't take long because acrylics dry so fast, that is why we have to kind of work quickly when we're blending. Now I will say, and I'm demonstrating it right here, it's very difficult to mix a lighter color into a very dominant dark color. Right now I just created a gray using white and black, and I'm just trying to create that little highlight in on the pupil. And that was difficult because of how strong black is. So when you're blending, you have to add a lot more of your light color to overpower any of the dark colors if you're trying to work light colors and blend them into dark colors. All I'm doing now is just mixing up the background color so I can just cut into where we opened up that eye, because I mentioned that there's something a little off with this dog's left eye. And I just opened that up, and now I'm just gonna fill in that white gap with the background colors. All right, now it's time to switch to a round detail brush or a very small flat brush. We're gonna start by blocking in the darker tones in the fur of this Doberman Pinscher. So what I'm going to use is violet and phthalo blue. I start with violet, but then I add in phthalo blue, and I use that color, that dark tone, to apply to all the darkest values in the fur that we see. And guess what? I'm actually looking for shapes. That's how I figure out exactly where those certain values are. I'm looking for the shapes it's making, and we're just looking for those dark tones. So instead of applying black, all the areas that I see black in my reference photo, I'm applying this dark value. And furthermore, some of those shapes are blocked in with our outline, and then some, like for instance here where I join these two shapes, it's not. So just take your time, pay close attention to every step. Make sure you mix enough of this color, that's phthalo blue and violet, because we cover a lot of the darkest tones. There's a lot that we have to cover in this pet portrait. And then don't get too caught up in detail. We can always reapply colors later. If we missed an area that should have been a dark tone, we can always create this color again or even apply a different color with the same value. My next tip, and I say it a lot, but it really makes a gigantic difference, If you ever feel your brush pulling on your canvas, or small details are really hard because your brush is so thick with paint that's dried to it, that's because you're not regularly washing your brush out in your water. This is especially important when we're dealing with long-haired dogs or medium-haired dogs. This is a very short-haired dog, so we really don't make a whole lot of fur texture, little continuous lines that we cluster together. We're not really doing that here because of how short his fur is, but it's very important still to help us move that paint around, to help us blend, to help us get into small areas. And also, we save actually a lot of paint that way. You just want your brush to be damp but not sopping wet and have a thin amount of paint on it at all times. Now, the important step between when you wash out your brush to when you're picking up more paint on your paint palette is having a cloth or paper towel that you can just dab your brush so that it's damp and not sopping wet. That's an important little tip that I don't think I mention enough. You want to have a cloth nearby so that it's not a sopping wet brush, because otherwise you'll have lots of drips, you'll have paint that's a little thinner and more transparent on your canvas. So feeling that and understanding kind of how that feels for beginners can be a challenge, and it just takes some time to get used to. All right, so I know that was quite a lot that we just blocked in around the face, and I'm still working on some around the jaw. But I'm going to switch to a medium flat brush, or you could even use a large flat brush, especially if you're using a larger canvas than me. And we're going to do the exact same thing, blocking in the darkest tones on the body now. And we're going to be working around the bow. All right, so do any touch-ups, any areas that you might have missed, or and especially the sides of your canvas down here, if you haven't already. And in a little bit, we'll move to just a little bit lighter tone using the same color. So you might want to mix up a little bit more of this color if you don't have much left, because we're going to actually be adding into it and just making the next layer. Thank you. Next, we're gonna add purple. It's literally just called purple. You can also mix white with violet if you don't have this color. But I'm gonna mix purple into my paint mixture that we were just using with phthalo blue and violet. And this will be our next layer. I'm using a round detail brush. This is actually a little bit bigger round detail brush than the one I was using. You can also use a small flat brush if that's more comfortable for you. But this is actually gonna be layered next to, I called hugging oftentimes, or over top some of the dark purples that we just applied. Okay, so to help us find these next values, we just look where we added those dark tones. We're either hugging them or layering them over top. So now, instead of looking for where the black areas are in a reference photo, we're looking for where those more dark gray tones are that are kind of leading into light grays. Okay, so we're kind of getting those in between layers that are very still dark, but not quite our medium tones yet. And make enough of this color because, once again, we add a lot. Thank you. Okie dokie, so now it's time to go a little bit lighter. Make sure you mix up enough of this color just so that we can make the next layers that we're adding. Okay, so what I'm going to be doing is starting with the eyes. I actually jump in with this color thinking that I needed to use the same color, but it's going to be lighter. So I'm going to add white into this paint mixture we were just using. Now, like I said, I actually didn't go add white yet, but later I find out that I definitely need more white. And if you need to, also add more purple as well. Now, if you can't tell the difference between this paint color and the last one we were using, add more white. And I had to keep doing that. I had to keep applying more white into this paint mixture because I really couldn't see much of a difference. So you want to see it being just a little bit lighter, not much, but just a little bit lighter. Now, if you've never done one of my tutorials before, you probably understand by now how I layer and how I block in the white with these different layers that we just lighten up a little bit at a time. And that's how I recommend you paint your pets, breaking up all the values into shapes, slowly but surely going from dark to light as you paint over the white, but also fill in all the details and the fur. Where I recommend you apply the fur is actually in this stage right here. Yes, you can start applying the fur and that texture, those clustered lines on the dark tones, but as we apply those little bit more obvious colors, that's where you want to use a very thin amount of paint on your brush. And oftentimes I'll use a flat brush to do this, where I use that flat edge to create those strands of fur over top the dark layers that I applied previously. Now, we're not really doing that here because this is such a short-haired dog, like I mentioned before. But if I were painting a lab doodle or a black lab or a Yorkshire Terrier, I would definitely start applying those little strands of fur, creating clusters of lines to create the fur. And I have several tutorials on fur, but I'll link them below for you in case you haven't seen them. But this is what I would call a medium tone. It's the color or the value that joins our darkest tones and our highlights. We haven't quite gotten to our highlights yet. All right, so the next color I'm gonna use, and now we're working on the brownish areas of the dog. I'm using cadmium red with raw sienna. That's cadmium red and raw sienna, equal amounts here. I want this to be my darker value for the dark areas of the brown area on the dog, okay? So around the snout, we see those brown areas. Little spots and markings on the ear and on the face, we see these areas. I'm gonna do the very same thing I did with the purples and blues on this part of the dog. So I'm going from dark to medium to light. Now the reason, you're probably wondering, why didn't you do your final highlights on the purple areas that we just applied on the fur and body? Well, that's actually because acrylic dries so much darker. And so I want to let that dry so I can really make better decisions on how light to make the highlights over top. So that's something I've learned recently, so that I'm not just constantly applying all these colors. I let it dry, and that can help me make smarter decisions on how much white and purple to add to my paint for those highlights.
Thank you.
To prevent any little white specks, leaving those, I am just switching to a smaller round detail brush. Just helps me to get into those little areas. So now I could get a little bit lighter by just adding a lighter tone into this color mixture we were just using, or I could actually do something a little different with similar colors. So what I'm going to do is get the color that I see around the ears that's just a little bit lighter. I'm going to mix in some purple and some more raw sienna. So this is just a tint lighter. But I'm actually really making this painting more interesting, more dynamic with my purple. I'm gonna make it just a tiny bit lighter by adding white to that. And I'm not gonna add this necessarily around the snout. We're gonna add more oranges to that. But I am doing this just because I wanna add more color, but still get a little bit lighter value there. Now I'm not gonna bring this color all the way down, filling in all the rest of the white in the ear. We're actually going to be making a pinkish tone to really pull out the pinks that I plan to add to the bow. So I'm planning ahead here with my colors. So I'm going to be very soon mixing white with my cadmium red. So here I go with my cadmium red into this mixture we were just using and some white. I want to make this a pink with a tint of brown in it, and I'm just going to fill in the rest of the white, but there are some areas that I should have painted my purple just on the lower part of the ear, so I'm going to paint around that and then just add in those darker values later. Now I absolutely love this part because this will really pull out the blues that we added to the fur. So I'm gonna mix orange with raw sienna, and I want this to be a medium tone, not too light. So about equal amounts orange and raw sienna. And this will be the next layer that I add to the areas that are more brown in the dog. All right, so now it's time to do the next layer. I'm going to be adding white to the previous color we were just using. You can also add a tiny bit of yellow to make it just more of a colorful painting. I'm going to add yellow and white to this mixture we were just using, and we'll be applying that to a lot of the leftover white. If you're wondering how I choose and mix and apply the colors that I do to my animal paintings, I've actually created a color guide that I have linked down below. Now, something that'll really make that snout look more realistic, especially where we have the root of the whiskers, those dots there, I'm going to create strips of this orange-yellow mixture. Just two or three is all you need, that are go kind of at an angle horizontally over top the orange. Oh, this is just looking so wonderful, guys. I am so excited for the next step because we'll finally add those highlights using just purple and white to the purple and blue areas of our dog. So purple and white, a little bit more purple than white. And I'm just gonna go over the areas that the light is hitting the most. Our light source is coming from the top and especially from the left side. And so I'm just going to block in all those lightest values. All right, so if there's any areas you may have gone a little too much into your dark purples or any of the darker values, I'm just going backwards, mixing my phthalo blue and violet and just kind of touching up those areas. So again, if you see any bits of white that should be this dark purple, fill that in now. The inside of the top of that left ear, it's the dog's left ear, our right ear, it's so complicated. I'm using just purple to make that a little bit lighter. Just the inside part, it's just getting a little bit lighter value there. I really don't like to waste colors, so if I'm using one color, I pause and I look for other areas where it belongs, other areas that has that same value, and I'm seeing that on the left ear as well as the left top side of that ear as it comes down to the forehead. I don't know about you, but I am very ready to paint this bow. So I wanted to have kind of a Valentine's Day vibe to this painting, so I'm using cadmium red and deep yellow. I really want to pull out the vibrancy of those reds, so I just add a little bit of that deep yellow. I'm going to start with the band of the bow first, wrapping around the neck. Of course, you can choose any color you want. I am making this bow more reddish and more pinks, but you can choose to make this a yellow bow that would look really nice with the purples, or a light blue bow that would look really nice with the oranges we have too, to complement those. I want to point out, because I had so much trouble painting in the bow itself, what I'm going to do is I'm going to fast forward, I'm going to tell you what I learned and what I recommend you do. And the main colors that I went with were actually a magenta for the bow, and then this color that I'm applying to the band for the center. So while we still have this color, if you want to add that to the center of the bow, you can do that now. And I'm going to fast forward now and show you my process. So I added in white to this color that we use for the band, just to lighten that up. I painted both the left and right sides of the bow, and then I wanted to go in with more of my dark reds for the center. Now, what I learned, and I don't recommend, is that when you're creating these little creases, these little folds closer to the center of the bow, I don't recommend using black, but you want to use a darker color while that pink area or whatever color you choose for the bow is still wet. Then once you've added that light color, you go in with a lighter highlight of the same color used for the bow and just add those highlights to those areas that aren't in those folds or creases. Now, I'm not done the bow yet. In fact, I go for more of a magenta tone, and I also add a little bit brighter oranges and reds to the band. So I'll show you that soon, but I wanted to make sure you saw the highlights, the final highlights that I added using white and phthalo blue to the nose. Thank you. All right, so I told you that I would show you the progress on the bow. Well, I started adding blue polka dots and that did not turn out right. It even blended with some of those pinks and I just couldn't get it right. So I let it dry and I started all over again. After everything, it turned out to be a very muddy gray blue, which I don't like. So it's completely dry here. I'm gonna be using more magenta tones and oranges to the reds as well to bring out those colors. Now we're gonna repeat those exact same steps that I just went over in just the time-lapse view. I'm gonna paint using magenta the left and right sides of the bow. And then I'm gonna use my cadmium red and orange mixture to fill in the center of the bow as well as the band to really just pull out those reds and vibrant oranges. That also helps to pull out the oranges in the around the snout. And then I'm going to use violet, not black this time, but violet, to cut in around the center, going out horizontally into the bow to create those folds. I'm going to mix my magenta with a little bit of violet for the dark areas that show the folds and the creases in the bow. I'm going to put two or three on both sides. And then I'm going to wash out my brush and lighten up these pinks with white and just add those final highlights around the bow. Now I'll let you in on another little secret here for painting pets. I kind of do this to all my animal portraits, but this is something I do a lot. If there's colors that I really love, for instance, I love this light pink in the bow. If I see any other light pink in the painting, whether it's in the background or especially in the animal, I'll just use this exact same color and apply it to that reddish or pink area. I'll use this even if it's slightly going against the values that I have. I actually just want to draw attention to this specific color. This pink here in the ear, it's supposed to be light, but I actually made it a little too light. And so it's okay though, because that's just how I have created my style. I want it to really stand out, lots and lots of color. All right, guys, I just want to say well done. This was a long tutorial. I hope I broke it down step by step for you. Right now, I'm just going to work on my touch-ups. So we're going to repeat all the same steps that we've just gone over. I might have some different things that I need to change on my painting. So it's important that you look at your painting from afar to see what you specifically need. But I'm going to show you from here until the end. I'm going to be showing you all the little fixes and second, third layers and additions of highlights and all that stuff from now until the end. I do want to make a note though, the thing that I didn't mention already that is very important detail is the little circles or dots that represents the roots of each whisker around the snout. You can use either phthalo blue for that or violet, but I'm just for that just going to go in with my detail brush and create little dots around those strips that we made along the snout. If you want, you can actually fast forward to that part. It's just right before the end, and I'll show you in more detail. I'm using a very pointy round brush. This is actually kind of a medium round brush. You can use a liner brush or a rigger brush too. But with violet, just violet, I'm just plugging in these little tiny dots going down along those strips of orange we made. You don't have to press hard, but you do want each circle to be about the same size. I'll apply this color to the left side of the snout, about three rows, as well as partially on the right side of the snout. Alright guys, so it's the end of the tutorial. If you remember me saying at the very beginning that I'm going to share with you some really exciting news, well, I am hosting a giveaway right here on my YouTube channel, and the winner will receive 1 month free in my online Enamart Masterclass in the Maine Coon tier. So like I said earlier, this is actually the tier where you get the 10-day masterclass challenge, you get over 100 animal art tutorials, pet and wildlife, you get all my guides and materials on how to price pet portraits, how to paint cats and dogs, everything. So, and how you get this giveaway is just by subscribing and commenting below with the animal that you really want to paint next. It can be any bird or insect or pet or farm animal, you name it. What is the next animal you really want to paint? I'll pick one winner at random and I will announce them in my next YouTube tutorial here on my YouTube channel. All right, guys, so thank you so much for watching. Make sure you comment below and subscribe for a chance to win my giveaway. Have a fantastic day. Bye. You say, take me on a treasure hunt. I long for something new. Have you heard the fairies when they sing and dance? Oh, I wish it was me. Just